Hi, and welcome to The People Who Build Australia. I'm Ross Greenwood. On the show this week, we're looking at the one thing we need more than anything else to grow as a country, and that's investment. And for most of us, that investment flows from our banks. Here in Australia, the Commonwealth Bank is the biggest of the big four banks, and only last month found itself getting even bigger again when its share price hit $100 for the very first time. But in many ways, the Commonwealth story is even richer. I spoke with the Commonwealth's chief executive, Matt Comyn, about where it's come from and exactly where it's going in the future. Matt Comyn, I want to take you back to the very start of the Commonwealth Bank. Just explain the political environment at that stage. Australia is literally 10 years into its new federation. Just explain how the Commonwealth Bank really comes into being.
There was a particularly significant banking crisis in the mid-1890s, where basically when international banks at that stage, almost the entire financial services system collapsed. About, you know, two-thirds of assets were wiped out. The Parliament recognised that the needs of Australia and Australians were not being well served by the structure of the banking sector at that time. And so obviously it took some time and they contemplated a range of different solutions, but ultimately there was an Act of Parliament that was passed in the 22nd of December 1911, which was really the creation of the Commonwealth Bank, which then sort of formally opened and started operating in July 1912. It was seen as deliberately to be there to be the bank for all Australians, to help all people prosper, and of one in which the nation should be proud. Not long after the time we're talking about, we go into the First World War, and the Commonwealth Bank plays a really important role in terms of helping to finance that.
I was going to ask you about that because the Commonwealth Bank is there and effectively is the government's financier for the First World War.
Yeah.
And we were still very much seen to be a part of the UK at that time. And so here is this Australian bank that is funding the government. And that clearly is one of those pivotal moments for the bank, its history and its recognition by other Australians.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it was a very significant event reputationally. And as you said, prior to that time, Australia was very dependent on England and access to financial markets. And obviously, as World War I takes hold, financial markets, as they do in significant events, start to freeze up. And so Australia really has to be able to stand more on its own 2 feet. And so the idea is they come up with is the war bonds and then the peace bonds. And so, I mean, at that time, I mean, tens of millions of pounds. It sounds, like quite a simple concept today, but you can imagine it was quite novel and required a lot of, innovation and courage to be able to, provide and facilitate that service, and again, from scratch.
Let's move to another important aspect of the Commonwealth Bank's history. There was no Reserve Bank.
Mm-hmm.
There was no Central Bank.
Yep.
And so, as a result, it was the Commonwealth Bank that actually became Australia's central bank.
That's right.
And the Reserve Bank actually was spun out of the Commonwealth Bank. Why does Australia need a central bank? And why is it that the Commonwealth Bank becomes that central bank?
Overall, as we know today, what we'd consider to be monetary policy, you need someone to be thinking about interest rates and expansion of money supply and being able to provide, again, financial stability and economic growth. And so as the economy grows and matures, a role needs to be created. You could either rely on the central bank from London, or you can start to sort of control your own destiny and have much greater control. The Commonwealth Bank assumes that role. It takes over responsibility, I think, for printing the currency in the 1920s. And of course, that's controversial as well in terms of the combination, as it would be today. Imagine if the Reserve Bank also had a commercial banking operation. It's effectively financing both directly to individuals and to businesses, but also to the government and providing liquidity and payments and effectively a balance sheet for them to be able to draw upon.
Just take me through Australia during the 1920s, because obviously the rebuilding from the First World War creates an enormous boom in Australia.
Yeah, absolutely. If you think about the events that took place then, as you said, World War One, and you've got the Spanish flu, and then you go through a real boom going through into the late 1920s, and of course then the stock market crash. There's a lot of strain on financial systems and institutions all around the world. So the Commonwealth Bank certainly tries to support the country during that time, but it's very challenging. I mean, Australia certainly doesn't escape, during the, 1929 to 33, 34, a very difficult, economic period, extremely high levels of unemployment and some of the, very detrimental effects that flow from that, which is why even in today, when we think about the government's response to COVID and the role that the Reserve Banks play, but also how focused they are on making sure we get unemployment down as quickly as possible, is because, I mean, there's enormous economic prosperity and social hardship is caused by having a lot of people out of work.
And there's an eerie parallel between then and today, isn't there, that the bank has got to deal with, that the community's got to deal with?
Yeah, absolutely. We've come through the Spanish flu, and if you look at the severity in particular of the pandemic, it's quite different, fortunately, to our experience. And if it's quite a sharp contrast, if you look at the rate of infection and also the death rate that happens during that time versus today. But interestingly, when you look through some of the archives, a lot of the messaging around, it's not called social distancing, but it's effectively the same. And, a lot of the crowds are restricted and dispersed. And I think, some of those lessons and how effectively it's been managed both has flown through with superior health outcomes, but also, as we've both seen, a very rapid economic recovery, which took much longer at that time.
It is my melancholy duty to inform you, Australia is at war.
Then we get to the Second World War. Mm. And of course, again, another effort to finance Australia's war effort. What sort of precautions were made to ensure the safety of Australia, the safety of the savings in the event that Australia was potentially raided? Were there things happening behind the scenes that you found out about?
Well, I know particularly around the financing. I mean, and that was a huge issue. And so in World War One, it was tens of millions of pounds. By this stage, it's more than a billion that's required. And of course, there's a bond issuance program which goes in various phases, and it becomes really, I think, part of the national psyche and becomes quite a rallying cry.
I want to now take you to the immediate post-Second World War period and another key figure in the Commonwealth Bank's history. Nugget Coombs, the first governor of the Reserve Bank, had also been the governor of the Commonwealth Bank. So just explain why he is such an instrumental figure in the history of the Commonwealth Bank.
Yeah, because until that time, as we discussed, the two are together. And I think it's a combination of things in terms of his thinking, and I suspect there was also, continuing tension with a number of other financial institutions because of that combined role. And so that's around the time in 1960 where there's a splitting between the two, and the commercial enterprise and activities of the Commonwealth Bank are separated from what we know today as the Central Bank and the Reserve Bank. And so if you go through any of the history and archives of the Reserve Bank, similarly you can see that connection. And Nugget Coombs being the first governor, effectively all of the mandates around the Reserve Bank and the Reserve Bank Act, etc., are all created at that time.
The separation of the bank and the Reserve Bank, mm-hmm. Do you think it got to a point where it was simply inevitable, that it just had to happen because, as you point out, the pressures of running commercial bank, the savings bank, and then being the central bank simply became too great, the functions became too great?
In today's context, there'd be seen to be sort of conflicts of interest, or perhaps sort of advantaged positions if you were effectively running and setting interest rates, and you were also both sending lending and deposits. It would have been, I think, a difficult role to continue to fulfil indefinitely.
Also, the second part about this is probably the increasing separation with the UK. eventually Australia, it is not in the common market. It's not there anymore. The European community is created. Australia, again, has to stand on its own two feet.
That's absolutely right. I mean, very focused domestically. And as you said, it's playing an important role at a time where Australia is really discovering more of its individual identity and independence. Of course, there's still close associations with UK and to an extent then at that time, developing connections with other parts of the world. It's still a bit of a boom or bust phase. And we, many, many years later, we go through a remarkable period in the lead up to COVID where we, 23 years of uninterrupted economic growth. But still at that time, there's a number of different shocks that occur in the 60s, 70s, another boom in the 80s, a pretty significant recession in the late 80s as well.
Unemployment has jumped to its highest level for 12 months.
An extra 27,000 Australians out of work.
This is a recession that Australia had to have.
During that time, there's a removal of tariffs and, in the lead up or throughout the 1980s, there's a complete opening up of the economy, deregulation, a number of very significant structural reforms which underpin a period of, real prosperity for the country.
Which leads to an enormous testing time for all banks. But there was one bank that was really, I think, at the height of the recession Australia had in the early 1990s, mm-hmm. was the State Bank of Victoria.
Yeah.
And that is where the Commonwealth Bank is not only its saviour, but it also, to a certain extent, catapults the Commonwealth Bank itself, and particularly its profile in Victoria, which had been weaker than in other states.
No, exactly. That ends up being a very significant transformational opportunity for CBA. But as you said, State Bank of Victoria has suffered huge losses, I think more than $2 billion of liabilities. And then Treasurer Paul Keating deserves a lot of that credit because he effectively, I think, was heavily involved in the negotiations. And there were a number of other financial institutions that were in real difficulty as well. And so orchestrating and making sure that the taxpayer wasn't picking up the losses, particularly at the Victorian state government. And again, as we talked about, you see a period there of consolidation. And so that really expands the Commonwealth Bank's geographical diversification, gets a much stronger footing in Victoria, a much larger deposit base. And it's one of the key contributors to why we've got about 29% market share of deposits today.
Australia's biggest share market float, the Commonwealth Bank. $1.5 billion worth of shares were issued at $5.40 each to 210,000 shareholders.
I just pulled out something, just get your reaction to this. So the government between 91 and 96 privatises the Commonwealth Bank and raises $8 billion. The Commonwealth Bank today is worth $152 billion. Good deal or not?
Well, I think so. I mean, it was obviously quite an extensive period of time, so if you compound that over that period of time, but it's a good return certainly for shareholders who participated. At the end of that in 96, I think we had about 400,000 shareholders or so. We've got about 860,000 households directly and, of course, millions more through superannuation. But there's still quite a few shareholders who are hanging on to those shares issued at $5.40 and understandably probably a little reluctant to sell given the capital gains tax.
Coming up, from the challenges posed by the Royal Commission, we look at the obstacles facing our biggest banks and what needs to be done to give everyone a fair go.
This program is brought to you by Meriton, Australia's apartment leader in quality and design for over 58 years.
It was the sting of the century, Operation Ironside. When cops declared war on Australia's underworld. But the war is not over. From the cartels in Mexico.
He sticks a gun in your face and says, I'll shoot your family.
To the streets of Australia, Sky News and Australia's leading newspapers expose the truth of Australia's cocaine crisis. Tonight.
It lives at first light. Wherever we push ourselves, when we pull together, it lives over the door, at the end of every paintbrush, after the sun has set. It lives in going for a six where a four would have done it. It lives in every square inch of this place. And because we live here, Cairn lives here.
At Harvey Norman, DeLonghi kettles and toasters from just $79 each. Dyson Airwrap Styler with bonus $100 Harvey Norman gift card. Plus, bonus gift card up to $1,000 when you buy on 60 months interest free. On now.
Feel like you're being watched? Hackers could steal the personal information on your device or see what you send over Wi-Fi. That's why Norton 360 includes a VPN, device security and more. Go to au.norton.com.
Moochies. Stay in touch with your child anytime, anywhere. Our back-to-school sale is now on. Ensure their safety with a restricted call list. And class mode to let them focus on the important things. Know where they are anywhere in the world with the Moochies GPS feature. And keep them safe in the real world and online. As well as other great features to love. Now on sale at $199.95. Buy direct or find us in stores today.
A global leader in the iron ore industry, Fortescue Metals Group is recognised for our culture, innovation and industry-leading development of infrastructure and mining assets, founded on the belief that local communities should benefit from our success. Together with Fortescue Future Industries, we will become a global resources and renewable energy company, supporting the world's transition to clean energy. At Meriton, we've built Australian dreams for generations. That's why, with a 100% completion rate, we are Australia's most trusted developer. Our multi-award-winning designs transform city skylines, offering exquisite quality and luxury living. Meriton, built for a lifetime. This program is brought to you by Fortescue Metals Group, empowering thriving communities, investing in the future.
Welcome back to The People Who Built Australia. Now, while significant national and worldwide events have shaped the way in which we do business and our relationship with our banking institutions, do remember, after the findings of the Royal Commission into our banks, there's a big question. Have we really learned to trust them again? What happens inside the banking industry in Australia that leads to the Royal Commission?
Only the government can ensure that a Royal Commission is created with responsible, comprehensive terms of reference. It'll cover the nation's banks, big and small, wealth managers, superannuation providers, insurance companies.
There's a number of different factors that the banking industry here doesn't take adequate steps to prevent or ensure, you know, great customer outcomes. We manage financial risk, as you and I have been talking about through all of those cycles, I think very well. But non-financial risk and making sure that customers are getting the right products and they're treated well and they perform the way that they would expect. And if customers have got issues or complaints, that they're adequately dealt with. And of course, there are periods where people are given very poor financial advice, and that can obviously be devastating, the impact for that.
Look, I think part of it was not really kind of being super clear about the nature of certain products, and being clear that the customer's interest, that the customer's kind of well-being had to be part of the product. So you did hear lots of stories about some of the products that the banks were using, you know, that were not fit for purpose really for people, particularly people who are marginal home borrowers and things like that. The whole question of you know, joint responsibility, not necessarily always assuming the customer is going to read everything. And look, you know, there were some pretty poor examples of that and some pretty poor examples of conduct. But I also think that the way that we should think about that equation is to remember that businesses and companies are people. There is this view I think Australians have got that somehow a business is a whole pile of people sitting around a board table. But it's not. The people who built Australia are the workers, the suppliers, the contractors, the shareholders, lots of whom are mums and dads, investors. There, that's what a business is.
I think they're quite unscrupulous.
I've got more credit limit increases sent through. When I tried to tell them I had a problem.
While the big end of town piled up profits, the little people were the losers.
An investment property to rent to someone else when we haven't even got a property to live in ourselves. Sorry.
Did the bank act in an ethical manner? I think it's fair to say we didn't.
Everybody simply asks themselves at that stage, can we trust that business? Can we trust that sector again? Or have they shown, as a result of what we've discovered through Royal Commissions or inquiries, their true colours?
I think in the case of the banks, you can, because I think it's not just the banks. I think what's been put around the banks in terms of the regulatory system, the watchdog role, the strengthening of APRA and ASIC, I think people can be pretty confident that that the systems are in place to kind of look at these things, to keep a watch on them. I think the community kind of won't tolerate that again, and the banks know that. But I also think we've got to give credit to the banks, you know, that they heard the message, that, you know, in the case of the Commonwealth Bank, a transformation of the bank has taken place. Some hard decisions, but decisions about the organisation is more important than anything else. Our customers are more important. And I think what we've seen in banking is a reorientation back to the customer. The customer matters.
We made a number of unacceptable failures to our customers, and that's the simple set of facts. And then there's more that we could and should have done to avoid that. But there's also been some very important lessons that have flowed from that. And I know both at CBA, but across the broader industry, as you'd expect, after having gone through that and a significant period of reform that's followed, we're very confident that we're a much better bank for our customers.
But while the Royal Commission refocused our big bank's attention on customer service, it also opened up new opportunities for smaller institutions, many of them using modern technology to build confidence and trust amongst customers, along with new banking products. Do you think Australia has sufficient competition amongst our banks today?
It's a lot of competition between the big four, but if you think about all the new players on the block, they don't have any old legacy system problems with their IT. They've never opened a branch and they probably never will. So their cost basis is vastly different. And they're online and they are talking to the young customer. And that's where, the young customer is what every business wants, not only banks. So I think we're going to see even more competition, particularly in that that younger market.
So you mind forward 20, 30, 40, even 50 years, do we still have these names, these four big names that we have today, or does things happen in the world that might change that, to change the nature of banking into the next decades?
You know, I can see a future where, you know, at least, a majority of our banks, there's likely to be changes just as there were in the last, 50 years about mergers and other things. But I can see a future where the majority of our banks, really pick up the opportunities that the new world is offering, and really drives them and delivers banking in ways that customers still want. I think it's a really exciting time in banking. You know, some of this, if we think about, blockchain technology and we think about cryptocurrencies, some of this might look vastly different, but it will still be at its heart, I think, some way of exchanging goods, services and value. And, what the shape of that is, who knows?
Well, I mean, clearly technology is going to play a really significant role. And at the moment, it tends to be through the mobile phone. Now, who knows what the device might be in 20 or 30 years. But the role of the bank in terms of keeping depositors' money safe and being able to facilitate payments, to be able to then use those deposits and lend, to be able to distribute risk, those needs haven't changed enormously. There'll always be a need to make some form of payment or an exchange for a good or service. But will it be through the local currency? Will it be some sort of crypto or alternative coin? Will you do that peer-to-peer versus via a trusted financial institution? I mean, there's some of the big questions. And I think, for me and for the bank, we have to have an open mind to make sure that we're, considering and contemplating that, to make sure that we continue to play a central role in our customers' lives and be able to demonstrate real value for them.
The fact that we do have some very large players in the market allows them to invest in new technology, take a risk on a few things. And it's not just the big four. We've got significant size in a number of Australia's regional banks. And then even in our smaller banks, they're able to jump onto things like new payments platforms once they've been tried by some of the larger players. that innovation is driving big change. It's driving huge efficiency. It's driving great convenience for customers. People carry their bank in their handbag or in their jacket pocket. And that kind of 24/7 total convenience, I think, you know, that's something that customers, we know customers really value it. And, you know, customers increasingly are voting with their feet. They want it online, they want it seamless, they want it fast, they want it as low documentation as possible. And I don't think that's going to change.
And would Sir Denison Miller, the first chief executive, the first boss, the governor of the Commonwealth Bank, would he recognise this organisation, this bank today?
Hopefully some elements of it he would. I'd certainly, you know, be fascinating to sort of, you know, compare notes, and there's the history of the Commonwealth Bank is really important, and really important to the people who are here to serve our customers, and you know, that service ethos and, you know, playing a broader role. And that was one of the things that worked incredibly well for us last year, notwithstanding the terrible context. But so many people worked hard because, you know, fundamentally, it's really exciting and motivating to be able to play a role in something bigger than just, you know, a day-to-day job. You're actually helping businesses survive, get through a pandemic, helping customers, you know, put their home loan repayments on hold, helping them get restarted, giving them the confidence, helping them, you know, provide information, and to be able to then facilitate, allocate capital, lend to people to see the economy now grow and recover. We're fortunate to be able to play that role, and, you know, I'm proud to be associated and to lead the Commonwealth Bank. It's an absolute privilege every day.
Next week on The People Who Build Australia, I sit down with high-rise Harry, that's Harry Triggerboff himself, and find out exactly what it takes to literally build Australia.